As children, longing for the past.
The Pope arrived at Yankee Stadium. As one enthusiastic announcer put it, he is standing on second base.
Reggie Jackson. Long drive, right field, it is. Goodbye. Big, big World Series for Reggie.
The Blue Jays are World Series champions as Joe Carter hits a three-run home run.
Back to throw.
So thick, brush them in the faces.
The 1-0 delivery to Fisk. He swings, long drive, left field. If it stays there, it's gone. Home run! The Red Sox win. And the series...
Lolis fires, ball is hit high in the air. This should be the series. Freehand waving, everybody win. Foul territory, Detroit wins.
Here's the pitch to Willie. Here's a liner straight to Richardson. The ball game is over and the World Series is over. Willie McCovey hit it like a bullet.
Baseball to mark the time.
The Oakland A's take.
I'll tell you what, we haven't heard.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Candlestick Park for Game 3 of the 1989 World Series.
It's been erased like a blackboard, rebuilt and erased again.
Frank Robinson, the right-hand batter.
Long drive.
With one out. Smith corks one into right down the line. It may go. Go crazy, folks. Go crazy. It's a home run. And the
curtain. Willie Mays just brought this crowd to his feet with a catch, which must have been an optical illusion to a lot of people.
This field, this game, it's a part of our past, Ray. It reminds us of all that once was good and it could be again.
Broadcast it live.
There are balls coming from all over the place. Left field, center field, right field. See, this is the kind of thing, quite honestly, right now, that makes you want to see the Chicago Cubs team lose.
Now, are you just saying you want to have fun, or do you really want to have fun?
It'll be fun.
Will the next person that sees anybody throw anything onto this field point them out and get them out of here? You don't live in Cleveland. Get out of Cincinnati.
You talking to me?
That is the farthest thing in the universe from the truth.
Hello, everyone. Live, it's the Dan Scott Show. And right there is your host, Dan Scott.
Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to the Monday edition of the program. I am your host, Dan Scott. Good to have you with us, and looking forward to spending the next hour with you here on what is turning out to be a beautiful day here in the upstate of South Carolina. Sunshine, blue skies. It was just a tick above 50 degrees when I walked into the building here at about 9:20 this morning, and I think we're heading towards mid-60s. It's going to be very spring-like, and I can almost smell it, and I know we've got more bad weather coming. I understand that, but it's after the first of the year. You got a day like today, and I think you know where I'm going with this, getting closer and closer to first pitch, right? February the 15th, college baseball season opens at the D1 level. Looking forward to it. Gonna jumble up the schedule, but I'm looking forward to it. We got a good show lined up for you today. I believe here in just a few minutes, Don Clardy is going to be in studio. Matter of fact, it may be him knocking on the door right now. Come on in. And we have been throughout the course of this football season that just transpired and actually wraps up tonight with the national championship game. Harkening back and celebrating the 30th anniversary of Furman's 1988 national championship. Well, we're going to talk about the championship game against Georgia Southern with Don Clardy here in studio coming up in just a bit. We are also going to let you hear from Furman head coach Bob Ritchie after his team's big win over the Citadel on Saturday. So two wins in a row after the short two-game losing streak, and the Paladins heading on the road again this weekend, Thursday at VMI, Saturday at UNCG. Tonight, we mentioned, it's the Alabama-Clemson matchup in the national championship game, college football playoff title game. Who you got and why? We'll talk about that coming up a little bit as well. And in the NFL yesterday, the magic of Nick Foles continues with the Philadelphia Eagles. And for Bears fans, you may want to chill out just a little bit, and we'll explain why as well. You know, our goal here, if your morning's off to a good start, we don't want to do anything to mess that up. If it's not going well, maybe we can provide you with a little bit of a lift. And at the end of the day, our goal is to learn something we did not know, and that usually starts right here in the host chair. So we'll go ahead and jump into our first break. When we come back, Don Clardy will slide into the seat beside me, and we will talk the 88 National Championship game between Furman and Georgia Southern. We'll do that right after this. Our show is brought to you each and every day by Carolina Creative, not just simple, but simply brilliant. And here's more about them as we head to the break. Hey, everybody, Dan Scott here, and I want to tell you about my technology partner, Carolina Creative Group. When my show needed a creative technology boost, I turned to Carolina Creative Group. My custom design website is going to take marketing as well as brand strategy and development to new levels. The search engine optimization means that my clients' ads will be seen by more people more often. And if I have any questions, Carolina Creative Group is just a phone call away. Friends, that is just the tip of the proverbial iceberg. You can find out all the ways that Carolina Creative Group can help your business by simply calling 864-250-2012. Again, that's 864-250-2012, or simply visit them online at carolinacreative.co. Carolina Creative Group, technology partner of the Dan Scott Show.
If you're looking for the perfect frame for that special photo or painting, Custom Corners Frame Shop in Seneca can deliver for you. Family-owned for nearly four decades, Trevor and the folks at Custom Corners Frame Shop pride themselves on quality, presentation, and professionalism. They offer picture framing for every budget, and every job is custom. Custom Corners Frame Shop also sells work from local artists as well as locally themed gifts. For more information, visit them at 289 Market Street in Seneca. Call 864-882-7736 or find them on Facebook, Custom Corners Frame Shop in Seneca.
Imagine a university. A university where your passion for protecting local water sources is encouraged. And now, your work not only benefits your career, but the health of those in your community and around the world. This is Furman. This is the Furman Advantage.
Dan Scott here for the Atlanta Bread Company. What do I like about Atlanta Bread? Well, too much to mention in a short commercial, but here are a few things. Bread baked daily fresh on site, a tremendous selection of soup, sandwiches, and salads, seasonal special additions to the menu, delicious hot coffee, and a bevy of other drink options, and yeah, can't forget about the baked sweet goodies. Dine in or carry out, and when you have the Atlanta Bread Company app, you can order and pay online, then breeze past the lines to the pickup counter to get your food. Experience it for yourself. That's the Atlanta Bread Company, Cherrydale Point in Greenville.
When you go in search of a fence company, what's your criteria? Experience? Trust? A company that gets it right the first time and stands behind its work? Then your search is over. Faulkner Fence has been Greenville's fence company for more than 40 years. Ed Faulkner started the business, and now Sun Todd continues the tradition of excellence. So regardless of your fencing needs, commercial, industrial, or residential, trust the company that Greenville has trusted for over four decades. Faulkner Fence, 864-271-4626, or online at FaulknerFenceCompany.com.
Let me tell you something, Cowboy. This rookie can really bring the heat.
He's smoky and spicy with a Chipotle style all his own.
It's a new Montgomery and Chipotle barbecue sauce. Make it a part of your home team.
Available now at your neighborhood grocer or online at CincyFavorites.com.
All right, welcome back to the show as we are just getting things cranked up on a Monday. Dan Scott here with Don Clardy, who has been joining us all season long since the beginning of football season, so kind of appropriate that we wrap up the day after, I guess 2 days after the FCS championship game between North Dakota State and Eastern Washington, and the day of championship night at the FBS level. How you doing, man?
I'm doing good. Glad to be able to get back in here and finish it up like we started the very first week. So.
Yeah, kind of bookending. He was in studio to begin, in studio here at the end. Everything else was via phone, but he was also on the injured list for a good part of that. So, you know, it's good to see you working out and doing your rehab so you could get back for the championship game.
Yeah, that's what it's all about, getting back at the right time, isn't it? It's all time.
Yeah, it's been fun walking this path and reviewing 88, and of course, for me, it's been as much educational as it has been fun, because as we pointed out in talking about the Furman Marshall weeks, I was on the other end of the spectrum 30 years ago. I was living in West Virginia, and obviously, I was rooting for Marshall at the time. So to get the kind of the week by week tutorial of that 1988 championship season for me has been a blast.
Yeah, much different perspective, obviously, from where you were 30 years ago. But now that you've figured
you're a
Furman guy.
I've seen the light.
It's an exciting, and it's been fun. It's been so much fun for me because my wife gives me a hard time and acts like I show my kids my old football tapes all the time. But it's been a long time since I've looked at and watched any of that. And just reliving it, remembering it, and talking through it with you has just been a blast.
And, the other side of that, too, there's a certain degree of this. It's not 100% that, but the loyalty is usually always to the one that signs your paycheck.
That's exactly right. So that's exactly right.
So I'm with Mike Buddy. all right, so it's been we took the break with the holidays, and of course so did the FCS playoffs. It's been 3 weeks, I think, between games. North Dakota State just won its fourth in a row, 7 out of the last 8, as they continue just to pound on people and win title after title. 1988, there was no such lull, right?
Yes, sir. There was no 3-week break to get healthy, as you see at both levels now. You know, you get a couple of weeks to get healthy. We may have had 1 week. I think we had maybe 1 week off, and then to the championship game.
So you did have a slight break.
Slight break, as I recall. Yeah, slight break.
And interesting, too, that for folks who remember the semifinal game, Idaho came here,
right,
to Timmins, Paladin Stadium. And then 2 weeks later, you go play the championship game where? Pocatello, Idaho.
The only interesting thing about that was it did have a feeling of home. I think you and I may have talked about it, because the dome in Pocatello, Idaho was modeled exactly after the ETSU mini dome. So I felt like I was, in some ways, just going right up the road from where I grew up and playing in ETSU's mini dome, because other than the fact that the surface out in Idaho was much, much better than it was at ETSU, they were absolutely identical stadiums.
So what was the capacity? Do you remember?
Probably 20 to 25,000, I would guess.
You
pretty
know,
big stadium.
For that level, that's not bad.
Yeah.
Same at the old mini dome?
Probably. I think they were pretty close to being exactly the same stadium structure. So I may be overestimating. Maybe it was 15 to 20, but I think it was definitely 15
still,
plus.
That's not bad at all.
Yeah.
That's not bad at all. What do you recall about the prep time before heading out there?
Before we actually left here,
right,
left Greenville? Probably not a lot. Just, you know, the basic grind, coming up with a good game plan. And as you know, as we've talked about all year, our game plan didn't change a whole lot. They ran triple option, so they looked a lot then like Wofford does now.
Mm-hmm.
We knew offensively what we were going to do. We were going to run the ball, power running game, option game, play action pass. As I watched the highlights of the game, I mean, I can almost do a tape recording, Dan, of what we talked about. Mm-hmm. We stayed true to what we do. You know, they did their thing. Our defense did a great job against that triple option that they ran, and it was just a great night in Furman football history.
The trip out, then, how far ahead of game day did you make the trip to Idaho?
My recollection is we were probably out there 2 to 3 days ahead of time. I know they had some activities out there. They had the festivities that we would go to. I remember it being bitterly cold and mm-hmm. being so thankful that we were playing in an indoor stadium, because it was mid-December in Idaho. So very, very, very cold. But just some neat activities for both the teams. We got to interact a little bit with the other team, but we pretty much stayed clear from Georgia Southern and kind of just participated in the activities and tried to, you know, stay focused. As you know, when you're in a national championship game, you kind of get it's kind of surreal. You can kind of get lost in that. So you really, the coaches did a good job of keeping us focused on the task at hand with all the activities mixed in.
It had to be a heck of a flight, too.
Long flight, and there wasn't a lot of sleeping on the way there or on the way back after the game, but yeah, long flight to get out to Idaho for sure.
So you get to Pocatello, you get through all the festivities, which are part of any championship week, any bowl week. They always have these things for teams, and then it comes time. It's time to laser focus in on game day. Do you remember anything at all about getting off the bus and walking into the dome on game day as you prepared to play that game?
I think there's probably a pull, you know, at least in my mind. I don't know how every individual handled that. There's the pull of thinking, okay, we're in the national championship, and then pulling yourself back and saying, okay, we got to treat this just like any other game. So I think it's that constant battle of still being surprised that you actually have made it to the ultimate game at your level, but then knowing you can't make this game a super big deal, or that will be a problem for you.
What was it, a good thing or a bad thing going into this that you were very familiar with your opponent, or did that play any factor at all?
You know, my familiarity was not a lot. As a program, we were, and certainly the seniors, they had a little extra momentum built in because they lost to them in 85. Mm-hmm. I'd only been around for 2 years, and at that time, they were not in our conference. So this is the first time I'd played Georgia Southern, but obviously we had the history with them. But I know our seniors, who we've already talked about what great senior leadership we had, it certainly gave them extra incentive to get over the hump that they just barely missed in 1985. Yeah.
This is Don Clardy. We are wrapping up our football season-long walk through the 1988 national championship season for the Furman Paladins. The hashtag here, all athletic year, even in 2019, is Diamonds Are Forever. It's a diamond anniversary of that 88 championship team. So let's get into it. Game starts. Kind of walk us through how things got rolling.
Yeah, started out, they got the ball first. I think it was probably a three and out, or quickly they had to punt. And there was on the first play, we had prepared a special play. We kind of felt they thought we would come out and just run the ball. We had a nice, what we thought we could get a nice matchup with Donald Lipscomb, our freshman wide receiver who had really come on at the end of the year. We did a reverse option look, had Donald running a deep post against a safety that lined up on him, and we were able to get a 45-yard completion the very first play that we had the ball. Unfortunately, we didn't capitalize on that, they ended up getting the ball back, having probably one of their better drives of the game. And as we talk through this, you'll understand why I mean this, what I mean by one of the better drives of the game, because they ended up kicking a 55-yard field goal. So it wasn't that they drove deep into our territory, but they did have a little drive and were able to make a 55-yard field goal. So they actually took a 3-0 lead midway through the first quarter. The thing that we were able to do is come back and immediately answer that by driving the ball all the way down the field. And we scored on about a 20-yard pass play, which was a very nice play action. Got one of our tight ends who didn't catch a ton of balls, but it seemed like every other ball he caught during that season was a touchdown. Greg Key caught about a 20-yard touchdown pass off of play action to put us up 7-3 by the end of the first quarter. So certainly not in control of the game, but in a pretty good place.
But important that you're able to come back and immediately answer in a game of that magnitude.
Yeah, absolutely. Very important to do that, and just feeling good being on top instead of having to play that game from behind.
So, second quarter?
Not a whole lot of action, just a lot of back and forth, punting. Jeff Blankenship was able to intercept a pass during the second quarter, and he would go on to have another big play at the very end. But defense just really dominated them. They really didn't do a whole lot. I think, you know, the final figures, they averaged over 400 yards, and I think we held them closer to 200 throughout the game. So really good defense on both sides. We moved the ball. We were in, for the rest of the half, we were more in their side of the field, but we were not able to get anything other than we did get a field goal from Glenn Connolly. So that, you know, we were able to stretch our lead to a full 7-point lead, 10-3 at halftime.
What was the conversation at half?
You know, obviously, it was not a big lead. You know, we were really playing each other pretty much head-to-head. We did have a lead. I think just keep doing what we're doing defensively and probably try to capitalize, you know, having been on their side of the field a lot in the first half, not capitalizing on several drives. We knew we were going to need to capitalize to make sure we could get to the finish line in the way that we wanted to.
Because you can imagine in Georgia Southern's locker room, they got to be telling themselves, look, you know, we didn't play well at all, and they spent most of the first half in our territory, and yet we're only down 7. So from that standpoint, you think they're probably feeling pretty good about things, all things considered.
Yeah, I think they did, although the way our defense played against them, You know, they're a confident team. They dominated people all year, so I'm sure they thought we just need to tweak a few things, mm-hmm. run a few things a little differently, give them a different look on offense, and we'll start rolling. But, you know, somebody probably had a little doubt creeping into their mind as dominant as our defense was in the first half.
And would continue on, right?
It would continue on. The second half played out in a very interesting way, for sure. Well, so,
keep us not in suspense, Don Clary. Tell us about that second half.
So we did have a little more back and forth in the third quarter. They had another, what I would call, a relatively short drive. Not another 55-yard field goal, but they kicked another long field goal. I think it was probably between 45 and 50 yards. So all of a sudden, you know, we're in a four-point game. Mm-hmm. We're up 10-6. And what we were able to do again was answer that with a long drive, a great combination of, again, running option. It's the people who've been doing it all year. Frankie had a really good game, called a good game, mixed in option, power running game, play action pass. All of our running backs made plays. John Bagwell, Dwight Sterling, Bobby Doherty, all of them made big runs. We end up going down the field, and Dwight takes a little – trap up the middle, playing fullback, takes a trap up the middle, I think 10 to 15 yard touchdown. So all of a sudden we're up 17-6 mid to late third quarter. So things are looking pretty good at that point.
So from that standpoint, you're up 11, and are you starting to feel it now, or is there still too much game left where you're not allowing yourself to kind of start thinking about that end game yet?
Well, I mean, I think we realize, hey, we're up here, our defense is dominating, we've got an opportunity to finish this game off. But I think there's also a tendency when your defense is playing that good to go conservative on offense, mm-hmm. and let the defense finish the game off. I think we probably did a little bit of that. And we get into the fourth quarter still having a 17-6 lead. But I'd say early to mid fourth quarter, they ended up having a huge play where they blocked a punt. I think we were punting from our own 40-yard line, punting to them, thinking we were going to get them buried back. They blocked the punt, run it all the way back for the touchdown.
Uh-oh.
So you want to talk about a huge momentum shift where we totally felt like we had been in control of the game, we're dominating the game, and then all of a sudden we're only up 5, and they're going for 2 to pull within 3 points. Fortunately, our defense got back out there, made a really good play on the 2-point conversion, put pressure. Kelly Fletcher, as he had all day, put good pressure on the quarterback, made him throw it a little fast, threw it out of the end zone. So it was a 5-point lead, 17-12, instead of a 3-point lead. Yeah. And we know that field goal kicker could kick it from a long way. So that helped to shut down that momentum a little bit, knowing they would have had to score a touchdown, which their offense had not been able to do the whole game. So
bring it home for us. Get us to that iconic moment at the end of the game when Jeff Blankenship made the interception that sealed it, and I think the moment everybody remembers him lying flat on his back with his fist straight up in the air. How did we get from 17-12 to that moment?
Well, as you know, in these games, they rarely go by without at least one last big, strong push from the team that's behind. And that happened probably with 4 to 5 minutes left. They drove down, and they were on our 10-yard line kind of going in. Again, the quarterback doing an outside kind of option run where he was keeping the ball, got past the line of scrimmage, looked like he was making progress to potentially score or at least be inside the 5-yard line. Kelly Fletcher from behind knocks the ball away. Wade Sexton, great strong safety all year, didn't get a lot of recognition. Senior, who'd been with us for a long time, recovers that. So that, as much as anything, was really the play of the game at that point. Everybody remembers Blankenship on that last drive. That was the play of the game because it was a very good chance that they were driving in to score a touchdown right there when we had that huge turnover. From there, it seemed like it took forever. It wasn't one more drive because, you know, they were strategically using their timeouts, and we got the ball back. We were going to go conservative at that point because we were inside our 5-yard line. We punt to them. I think they turn it over on downs. Then we get the ball back. And they have enough timeouts to get the ball back one more time, but it was inside less than 1 minute. They had the ball on their side of the field. They're having to throw the last couple of drives. They're having to throw the
ball.
Which is
not their strength.
No, that's where we wanted them. So they really never came close to making the big play. We did a great job. And as you said, I think there were 35 seconds left in the game where they tried to throw a curl route. And as Jeff had done earlier in the game and as he had done so many times that season, he knew exactly where to be, picked the ball off, ran it back down to their 20-yard line, and we were just able to kneel down and call it a game. And it really was just hard to believe. I mean, you see guys get interviewed after they win a championship, and they're always saying, it's not real. Mm-hmm. I can't – but it truly is that kind of feeling. It's almost like you're outside of yourself saying, did we really just do this? It's hard to – you don't, or I didn't have this rush of excitement. I think a lot of guys did. It was just kind of a surreal moment. It took a while for me for it to sink in.
How long did it take?
You know, it sinks in over the years. It just sunk in over time. But certainly as we got back to Greenville, we flew all night, I think, and got back. And you've got a lot of people waiting on us at the airport. Then you've had some time for it to sink in.
They didn't let you stay in a hotel that night, huh?
No. We had a tight budget there back in the day. So the budget was tight, and we did not stay in the hotel. We flew back all night, as I recall, and got back early the next morning.
Well, that would have been the NCAA paying for that, though, in the playoffs,
well,
right?
That's true. Maybe they so didn't, they had a they tight didn't budget. Have as big of a budget either, at least at the 1AA level.
Right.
They didn't. But getting back and people being there to welcome us back, you know, we went on to have banquet. It's funny, one of the things I talk about all the time, and you know, Dan, how much different downtown Greenville is than it used to be. We had a parade in downtown Greenville, and I tell people all the time when we're talking about downtown Greenville and what a showcase it is, I'm like, the only time I remember going to downtown when I went to school at Furman was when we had our parade that went right down Main Street, because it just wasn't somewhere that you went. But
and when people, if you have occasion to come into the lobby of this beautiful football building that we're broadcasting from now, as soon as you walk in the doors, to your right there is a television screen that has different videos looping on it, and one of those videos is a bit of a clip, extended clip from that parade.
Yeah, absolutely.
So people can get a little bit of a taste of what that's like. That had to be a nice moment.
Yeah, and it was. And we got, you know, a lot of recognition around the school. Furman has had a great athletic history in a lot of different areas, but it really is an academic school. So we always laugh, being from East Tennessee. And East Tennessee State at that time was not very good. They usually had losing seasons, but their football team got treated like they were – you know, the hottest thing in town. And finally we win a national championship, and we felt like, hey, you know, we're getting recognition by the community, by the student body, which didn't always, you know, happen. So it was just a great feeling to have that respect and to earn that.
Kind of the same thing now, unfortunately.
Yeah, I mean, there is some of that. But that, when you have an academic institution that is so strong academically, you're not, you know, there are very few places like Duke basketball, I guess, you know, if you know what I'm saying. So.
Well, you know, it's been, like I said, it's been fun for me, educational for me to go through these games week by week and get to the championship game. And I hope our viewers and listeners have enjoyed it as well, because it's been a real treat to help celebrate this 30th anniversary of the 88 championship team. All these years later, does it mean as much? Does it mean more now than it did at the time? How do you view that now?
You know, I think it probably does mean more, especially with it having been the only one. You talk about North Dakota State winning 7 of the last 8, but I look back and realize that is such a freak thing that a program can dominate like that, just how hard it is to win a national championship. Yeah. So, you know, you come back now, we just had the 30-year celebration, got recognized on the field, and I'm looking at the team, and they're looking at us with the respect, and you can just tell, you know, that it's special, and mm-hmm. it is special, and it's something we'll always have you, that you most guys, people
you,
don't.
You got something they want.
Yeah, absolutely. And we did something that most of the people are never going to accomplish, and that all sinks in. So I think it's more special now probably than it was immediately, even though the fanfare and celebration is gone except for these special occasions. When I think about what we did, it's just a great feeling.
As we have done each and every week, giving an opportunity to tell people what you're doing in your real world, real life job now.
Sure. You know, we've talked about a lot of the individual pieces of what I do. But again, today, to wrap it up, we really just, you know, help our clients who are...
It's Northwest Mutual, by the way.
Yeah, it is Northwestern Mutual that I'm affiliated with. And we help our clients ensure that they're financially secure. So that means, you know, making sure they save enough money for their children's college education or their grandchildren or whoever it may be, making sure they're saving enough money and doing it in the most tax efficient and the best way for retirement, making sure they're protecting against things coming off the tracks if there's an unexpected death, disability, long-term care need. We're very comprehensive and help folks in all those areas. So anybody I can help in that arena, I'd be happy to talk to them. I can be reached at don.clardy at N as in Northwestern. M as in mutual.com.
So many N's and M's you could use.
Yeah, that's right. And then the number down at our office, 864-679-3849.
Well, listen, man, it's been fun. I've enjoyed it. We'll see if we can't cook up another reason to have you on.
Yes, sir. Love to do it again. If you want to do the 89 season, I'll be glad to do it. Probably not as much interest in that, but another great year. I may go back and look at those Satterfield shows now that I'm on a roll.
The year that Don Clardy caught his first touchdown pass.
Exactly.
1989. All right, we'll take a break and come back. We'll shift gears, come back to the future, and talk about Furman's win over the Citadel on Saturday. Let you hear from head coach Bob Ritchie. That and more as the Dan Scott Show continues in just a moment.
For a child battling a critical illness, a wish come true can be a turning point. One song, one dance, one game, one moment changes everything. Make-A-Wish needs your support to grant more life-changing wishes. Visit Make-A-Wish online now. Together, we can transform lives one wish at a time.
Hall's Chop House in downtown Greenville is the Greenville Steakhouse. Why? Well, it starts with the Allen Brothers Prime Steaks out of Chicago. The rest of the menu falls into place there. But it really goes beyond that. It's their level of service, their commitment to that service. The place is packed every night, and yet Billy and his staff have a way of making you and your table feel like you're the most important table in the place. They have lunch on Fridays and Saturdays, brunch on Sundays, live music every time the doors are open. The Greenville Steakhouse is Hall's Chop House, Main Street, downtown. Tell them you heard about them on the Dan Scott Show.
Mayhem is everywhere.
I'm a fight in the stadium parking lot. One of us was rooting for the home team. The other was also rooting for the home team, but misheard the first one. Them is fighting words. Now we're working this out all over your car. And this could last a while because we're evenly matched. We're both big. We're both better at punching stuff than doing puzzles. We both think Italy's in South America. We both peaked somewhere between 8th grade and the second time we took 8th grade. Oh, and while you were gone, we've both been rammed repeatedly by the other into your car. Our already scarred faces will heal, but if you've got cut-rate insurance, you could be living with these dents. So get Allstate, where agents help keep you protected from mayhem. Like me.
Are you in good hands?
And easily, it's Ray Williams, Allstate, 864-859-7504.
Looking for a great car, but your credit needs work? Premier Automotivations is a professional referral service motivated to help you drive a car you love while rebuilding your credit. Late model cars of all kinds. Premier Automotivations can get you on the road and your credit on the road to recovery today. Serving all of upstate South Carolina, it's Premier Automotivations. Call Sherry today at 864-722-3785 or email cricketgravely@gmail.com.
Go the Distance Performance Coaching offers individualized coaching for distance runners of all ability levels, beginner to seasoned runner, and exists to help you achieve your running goals. All training plans are custom built, tailor-made just for you based on your experience, current fitness level, entry history, and goals. You're going to receive expert coaching from Hall of Fame runner Brock Bailey, and Coach Brock is ready to help you go the distance. You can find out everything you need to know about Go the Distance Performance Coaching and Brock Bailey at the website gocoach.run. Gocoach.run. That's Go the Distance Performance Coaching. Our thanks again to Don Clardy for wrapping up what's been a fun series going back to the beginning of football season and coming week by week through the 1988 national championship season for the Furman Paladins, diamond anniversary of that group, and it was a fun trip. As we get back into play, we come back to present day activity, and that leads us to talking about Saturday's 101-85 Furman win over the Citadel. Citadel came in averaging a nation's best 99 points per game, and the Paladins held them 14 points below that average. It really did a nice number on them defensively in the second half especially, and that's also when things finally got going offensively for the Paladins. In the second half, they hit a few more shots from the perimeter that opened up things, and then when the Citadel started missing shots, it led to some fast break opportunities, and the lead suddenly jumped up to 20 at one point, and the Paladins rolled on to the win. So now 14-2 overall and 3-1 in the Southern Conference. And after the game, Bob Ritchie sat down and talked with the media about his team's second straight win in SoCon play.
I think it's pretty safe to say that's the best environment in the history of the program with no students around. And I think that's important to note. I think that played a factor in the game today. I think it's another measure of growth in the program and what we've been able to continue to progress with here. And we didn't have any student help, but you felt it. And it was loud. And, you know, when we went on that run in the second half, just to be able to play games with energy like that and with community here and with support here and to see it, you know, and the people that are talking about it, it's a phenomenal deal. And looking forward to seeing it continue to grow. But just want to make sure I put that out there. Appreciate everybody coming out today and supporting this team. You know, there's a lot I can say. Really, really proud of this group. I don't know how many times I've been asked in the last 48 hours, how are we going to handle the press and how are we going to handle the tempo? And they did, period. You know, we did handle the press and we did handle the tempo and we really made the run when we got stops and we got in transition. And, you know, for us to play four halves in a 72-hour window and have to play against that pace in the second game for our fourth half to be the best half of those four is a statement of character to this group. And, you know, Matt Rafferty, it's just, I know it seems like a broken record, but career high today and 12 rebounds. Didn't miss a free throw, three steals. And what you will not see in the box score is the reason we were able to handle the press is because I was crazy enough to put our five-man in press offense. And that's something that, you know, some people might notice, some people might not. Usually you're going to see presses and you're going to see a two-guard front. And I got my five-man up there taking a trap. And he's making all the right reads through it. And it allowed us to be able to have our best handlers and decision makers up. And we were able to get pretty good shots behind it and still allow to stretch it. And I thought that was a huge key to the game, to be able to handle the press at our tempo, not allow them to speed us up. And then once we got into the half court, making sure that once we saw the pressure, that we've got to make sure at that point, then we're at our pace, right? We can't stay frantic there. We've got to stay composed and stay under control. And I thought we were able to do that. So, you know, phenomenal basketball game. I thought Citadel, you know, first half, I mean, man, they were hitting everything. And it was back and forth. I mean, Rice obviously hit those shots to start the game. He got hot. Stallworth is a heck of a player. And we couldn't keep him out of the paint. It's just, and it wasn't, you know, Alex was trying as hard as he could, but it was just, I mean, he's a player. He's a load. He's a man. And I thought he did a great job keeping pressure on us even after makes. And, you know, Trey did a great job coming in the last 10 minutes and doing a better job with his size and length. But once we were able to slow them down a little bit from three. Some of them were just misses, you know, and I obviously saw that. But, you know, once we were able to not see the ball go in the net from the perimeter from them so many times in a row, and then we were able to contain his dribble penetration, then I thought we were able to create a little bit of separation and get the margin a little bit higher.
With obviously the rebounding advantage you had today, they missed nearly 33. They missed 29 threes and had three offensive rebounds. You know, sometimes you can do a good job rebounding and not get a rebound because it's long to miss three. What was the key to everyone stepping in?
You know, we had three big keys, and that was the third one, that long shots go to long rebounds, and I thought Mercer got a couple of those in the game here. That just it's where your ones and your twos, they're used to getting out in transition and starting the break, but you've got to stay engaged in the possession. And it was just a big emphasis that, you know, we can't go until we get, and once we get it, then we can go. But until we get it, we can't go. And I thought Jordan and Alex and all our perimeters did a pretty good job of seeing a lot of those long shots. And then our forwards, I mean, it's why we've had to go back the last couple games, the last two games, and specifically of playing Clay and Noah and Matt out there together, because it's just at our level, it's a lot of size and length, and it's three guys that can really go get the basketball. So, you know, just a mentality, and I thought we came with it today to try to hold them to at least one, and that was going to allow us to be able to get out in transition.
Talk about the job you did defensively on Matt Frierson. He had one three-pointer, I guess, today, and he came in the week, I think, averaging five three-pointers, which led the nation. Was there something that you guys were able to do defensively?
You know, it's one of those things where we just – Jordan Lyons I thought it was one of his best defensive games of the year, and I thought he took the challenge, you know. And Jordan did a great job on Thursday on Cohen, dealing with more of a ball handler and an attacker. And Alex was the one that got the Cummings matchup. And we didn't know, you know, with the quick turnaround of the game, you know, what are the legs like? Can Alex really chase around a guy again? And so – we asked Jordan to do it, and we asked him in full confidence, and we knew he could. And I thought he took a lot of ownership to it. I really thought he did it. He took a lot of pride in it. And the way he chased through the handoffs, the way that he didn't have any lapses in his perimeter defense, and even got airborne on that one loose ball, that was phenomenal. You see guys get on the floor. I don't know how many times you see somebody get airborne. I looked over. I mean, he's like 3 feet off the ground. And, you know, just like we talk about all the time, right? You do those things, and the next thing you know, Alex is laying the ball up, and it gives you a momentum spark. But it was mainly Jordan. But, you know, they also put us in some switch situations that we had to make sure we communicated well on, and it was a team effort. But we did a pretty good job there. Didn't do quite as good a job on Rice, but we did a good job on Frierson.
This kind of goes back to the rebound, and they had 0 second chance points in the second half. I mean, it was pretty even in the first half, but you held them, no second chance.
Yeah, you know, I've competed against their staff for years, and Coach Balkan was the head coach of VMI, and, you know, Daniel was with him, and one of their assistants now played, and you know they're great coaches, and it's a unique scheme. But you know, one of the big keys to their scheme's always been, because of the long shots, you know, they can go in there and get running rebounds, and you know, it's something that you've got to really kind of reprogram yourself on. And you know, it's we had more length, so we did have an advantage there, but I thought our intent was good on that, to make sure that we finished possessions. And you know, I don't know all the rebounding numbers, but, you know, Clay, I mean, I thought Clay was active. I was worried about him when he gave Rice the two early threes, but came up to me. It's just why this team's so fun to coach. I mean, before we could even get to the media, he walked right up to me and said, "Coach, I'm sorry. You know, it's my fault. It's not going to happen again." And, you know, it's for him to stay engaged, to give up those two threes right there, and for him to own that, and then to get back in the game, and then to go out there and have a double-double, I don't think you can understate that. And just had to get on him for giving up a warm-up line dunk and pulling up for three right there in transition. But other than that, I thought he had a really good game.
Seemed like every time, especially y'all do something silly, hit a three and be down three or four, you know, on the line. And that seemed to coincide with Jordan Lyons really starting to feel it there.
You know, Jordan as much as we talk about Matt and we talk about all the great pieces that we have, nobody has the ability and personality to spark our team like Jordan can. And when he plays with that spark, like, you can just feel it. I mean, he walked up to me with about 8:30 to go and looked me square in the face and said, "I don't need to come out. I'm good the rest of the game." And I'm not arguing with him, because I can see the look, right? I can see the confidence. I can see the intent. I can see his energy and where it's at. And, hey, go, right? And he was about – he knew his rotational turn was coming. And I looked at the staff. I said, "Leave him." And sure enough, hits the big three, gets the layup. Because he just, like, it's one of those things, like, I've been telling him the past couple of days, focus on D, you'll still hit the three. And I've just been saying it to him over and over and over. Focus on D, you'll still hit the three. And just let that settle you. You know, let focus on your energy, focus on your communication, because he is. I mean, he's a spark. He's an energy guy. If he walks in here right now, you guys are going to feel him. You know, I mean, he's just one of those magnetic personalities. And when he channels it all in the right direction and he just goes out there and plays as hard as he can, it's amazing the impact it has on our team. And he can really rally a group. He can really start, you know, through his talk and through his energy, he can really change the demeanor in a huddle. He can change the demeanor in a room. And that's going to suit him really well in life. I mean, that's going to – when he takes that and puts that all in positive channels, that's going to be a trait that can carry him a lot of places. But when he does it for our team, it helps us. And vivid memories. I mean, I could talk about a bunch of them, but vivid memories at Villanova, listening to him in the huddle when we're down. You know, vivid memories listening to the huddle at Loyola when we're down and just pleading with our team to stay with it and keep grinding and keep doing it. When he does that for us, he's a big-time, big-time leader.
I know we're just still in the first third of the SoCon schedule, but how important is this three-game road swing, especially with UNCG and Wofford?
You know, it's every single one of these games is of high importance. And, you know, I don't think you can – get in a really, hey, this one has more meaning than the other. You've got to be able to go play your best, attempt to play your best, see what happens, and you got to quickly get on to the next one. And I think what we've got to do is we've got to resist the temptation to figure out what's this look like, how's this going to affect things. You just got to focus on that next game. And, you know, the league, I keep telling everybody, I mean, this the league's phenomenal. And it's gonna be a big time game every single night out. VMI was up 8 at halftime today on Greensboro and took them all the way till the end. And I think Greensboro hit a big three and ended up winning by 3, if I'm not mistaken. But you know, there's no gimmies. You know what I mean? Like Sanford, I think they lost at Western today. I'm just telling y'all, like it's gonna be wild. And but what's consistent so far is the home teams are playing really well at home. And so we're going to go on the road, and it's a league where you got some heavy home court advantages right now. And we've got to go be our best, and we've got to make sure that our defense travels. We got to make sure our connectivity travels. We got to make sure our communication travels. We're not going to be able to guarantee how well we're going to shoot it, but we got to be ready to go play as hard as we can. Can I add one thing? I know we already cut it off. Sorry. Trey Clark, not sure I've seen – I was trying to add up my years real quick at doing this. I've done this for 13 years now. Feels like 3. Not sure I've seen somebody grow in 6 months the way he has. And I just want to make sure everybody's clear on that. And I want to make sure everybody understands. I brought him in Monday and asked him to play backup point. He goes out there, hits 2 threes, right? Everybody in the offseason, well, can Trey Clark shoot? I mean, he's in the 40s still. He goes 2 for 4 today. He defends Stallworth. He handles the ball versus the press. His growth, his demeanor, his confidence, I mean, unbelievable. And what he means to this program right now, it was a major, major mistake on my part how I handled him last Saturday in Johnson City. It's a huge regret. And brought him in, made that right, and he has been a huge piece in both of these wins. And I just want to make sure from a media standpoint and a fan base standpoint, if it wasn't evident enough to the visible eye, he means a ton to this program right now.
So that's Bob Ritchie after the win over the Citadel on Saturday here at Timmons Arena. And I thought those were very pointed remarks about Trey Clark and what he means to this team. If you looked at his stat line on Saturday, it was impressive, not so much in the scoring, just 6 points, but the rebounds, the assists that he had, the defensive job that he did. And as Bob said, all of a sudden now, acting as the backup point guard and doing the ball handling that he's doing against the Citadel pressure. It was impressive. The young man has been phenomenal. We'll take a quick break, come back, and put a wrap on things for this Monday edition right after this.
When you're looking for the home of a lifetime, you need a realtor you can trust. With more than 27 years experience selling real estate, Gelsartain is the choice to help the discriminating buyer find the home of their dreams. Licensed in both South Carolina and Georgia, Gel specializes in homes on beautiful lakes Hartwell and Kiwi, as well as the surrounding areas, and has a wealth of experience working with people with technical backgrounds. Now is the time to buy, sell, and invest in real estate in the Clemson-Seneca area. Let Gail help you realize that dream today. Call her at 404-317-3171. That's Gail Sartain, a member of the National Association of Realtors.
We're all trying to find our way. Forge a path. Blaze a trail. The work is hard, and the work is personal. But you can't do it alone. At Furman, we're committed to giving you an advantage, the Furman Advantage. We know that graduates who are emotionally supported and who have deep learning experiences in college are three times as likely to be engaged at work and thriving in life. At Furman, all students are guaranteed 4 years of rigorous classroom education integrated with high-impact research, internships, study away, and a community of support every step of the way. This is the Furman Advantage.
Hey everybody, Dan Scott. You know, I've been telling you for some time now that I switched to protection of my home and family to Security Complete. I can tell you that I've been ecstatic with the results. Locally owned with more than 40 years experience in the industry, Security Complete uses nothing but the latest technology, which equals low overhead, which equals greater savings to the customer. Fully automated systems with monitoring rates much lower than the competition, Security Complete gives you all this and does not require a contract of any length. Find out more by calling 864-546-0630 or find them on Facebook and Twitter. Security Complete, my first line of defense. Make them yours today.
Let me tell you something, Cowboy. This rookie can really bring the heat.
He's smoky and spicy with a Chipotle style all his own.
It's a new Montgomery & Chipotle barbecue sauce. Make it a part of your home team.
Available now at your neighborhood grocer or online at cincyfavorites.com.
Hey, everybody. Dan Scott here, and I want to tell you about my technology partner, Carolina Creative Group. When my show needed a creative technology boost, I turned to Carolina Creative Group. My custom design website is going to take marketing as well as brand strategy and development to new levels. The search engine optimization means that my clients' ads will be seen by more people more often. And if I have any questions, Carolina Creative Group is just a phone call away. Friends, that is just the tip of the proverbial iceberg. You can find out all the ways that Carolina Creative Group can help your business by simply calling 864-250-2012. Again, that's 864-250-2012, or simply visit them online at carolinacreative.co. Carolina Creative Group, technology partner of the Dan Scott Show. Now we're back with just a couple of minutes to wrap things up here on the show. Thanks to Don Clardy for coming in and putting a finishing touch on our look at the 88 title team following that championship season week by week. It was fun. Hope you enjoyed it. And just kind of going along again with our year-long celebration and hashtag here, Diamonds Are Forever on campus. It was a fun little journey. Tomorrow is a very good possibility that I won't be here because of a couple of different factors, but on Wednesday, Dave Glenn will be with us, and then on Thursday, we'll catch up with Billy Davis again before he takes off out of town. That's what's coming up in the next couple of days, or next couple of shows anyway. Right now, though, as we get set to wrap it up, I just ask, hey, who you got? Tonight's the big one, the college football playoff championship. Alabama and Clemson, fourth consecutive year, third time in those 4 years they've played in the title game. They have split the title games. Alabama won in the semifinals 24-6 1 year ago. So here you are in the championship game. So who do you got? Tweet me your pick to at Dan Scott Show, and we'll kind of review those when we talk about the game, if I am here tomorrow, and if not, definitely on Wednesday. But to me, this game comes down to which offensive line protects its quarterback better. And will Clemson missing Dexter Lawrence be a bigger factor than Alabama missing one of its starting linemen? I don't know. I would tend to think that Clemson's depth is better on the defensive front. And because of that factor, I'm going to say they do a better job of protecting Dexter Lawrence. They get after Tua and force him to do a lot of running around, and we'll see what kind of plays he can make on that repaired ankle of his. I think Clemson wins this in a shootout. I think it's going to be a close game. I think there are going to be some points put on the board, though, by both teams. But I'll take Clemson in a close one by a touchdown or less to win that one out in San Francisco, or technically Santa Clara. Who you got? Tweet at Dan Scott Show and let us know. Thank you so much for your attention today. Back with you again either tomorrow or Wednesday. And we'll have another full show lined up and ready to go. Until then, go out, make a positive difference in somebody else's life. And I'm Dan Scott saying God bless you. So long, everybody.